a tremendous opportunity and privilege and all that stuff to grow up in the shadow of a brother like Anatole. If you know him, I tell folks this, most of what I have become is because of trying to be like my big brother. He has been a tremendous inspiration to me, and I haven't told him a lot of this stuff, but he has been. One of the things most interestingly is that he told me that he doesn't sing anymore. And that is interesting, because my love and my passion for singing came from hearing him years ago in church. And I was surprised when he told me that. But anyway, my name is Garvin, and I reside in Brooklyn, New York. And I'm feverishly working on a ministry, if you saw your flyer or you can read the poster behind me, that is called Hidden Ministry. And that is what has motivated my whole impetus, how I have approached the study of scripture and the way I share scripture. And I spent quite a lot of time in nursing homes, and I have learned and that you need to be simple, and you need to find ways to share truth that is pregnant, that is there in the word, that we have so often overlooked. That is why today I will be spending some time in the book of Luke chapter 15, looking at a story that is quite familiar, if not really familiar to most of us, to the point where all of us can probably recite that story without even looking at the scripture itself. So I am going to be hosting very soon a program, Hidden Content, Overlooked Truths Uncovered. And again, the reason is, you would see from just listening to me today that there is really a need to be a little more careful with the things that God has said. I have three kids. One is 21, I think. One is just about 18, and another is six, going on 25. I am a husband of one wife, and I have some really good friends around me that I must mention. Melissa, if you've seen her, is one of those, and great support. Mommy in your older age. So again, it is such a wonderful experience and to just be able to talk and share with the folks from all the way across the world. And I think this crisis that we are in has brought us to this point where there are things that we learn and things that we can do that we would not probably have done before. So without further ado, I just want to pray and get into the Word of God, if that's all right with you. Father, we thank you again for your word to us, and we thank you that you have promised that if we seek, we will find. If we knock, it will be opened. If we ask, it will be given. We pray, O Father, that today, even now, your Spirit would come as you have promised to lead us into truth, because you said the truth will set us free. And O God, today, even now, we want to be free. We want to know what it is to be free, to be free, to be free, and to be sanctified. So bless us as we look into your words today, is our prayer in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. If you can go with me to the book of Luke, chapter 15, Luke 1:5. Luke chapter 15. And I will just summarize the first 15 or 16 verses of the story, because you are very familiar with the story of this son who comes to a point in his life where he thinks that he's in control and he knows what he's doing. And there he approaches his father and he makes a plea, a petition, which the scholars have said it's a bit rude and presumptuous to ask the father for the inheritance that is his while the father is still alive. And the father, as humble and as understanding as he is, gives to the son his portion of the inheritance. As we all know, he takes it, and we spend a lot of time talking about him as he uses this inheritance to enjoy life as he thought he could. But circumstances tell us that he gets to a point in his experience where things run out. The money is finished, the friends are gone, and the circumstances are hard, and he finds himself in what we call back in Trinidad in a pig pen. He finds himself in a really adverse situation where he doesn't even have food enough to eat. from a man who has left a kingdom, a palace, a place of great provisions. He gets to a point where he's nothing. But interestingly, I'm just, if you followed me, this is just a summary. It's just a summary. We get to the point in the text of verse 16, and the Bible says, and he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man give to him. All his friends are gone, and all his means are gone. And verse 17 says, and when he came to himself, he said, and this is where I want to spend the time today, because all of us at some point in our lives have been in a pig pen. All of us have, at some point in our time, were in some kind of adverse situation. And some of us talk about being born in the church and all of that, but this is not what this is about. This is about circumstances in our lives where we are in a mess, where we are not where we should be. We are not eating what is really our type of food, and the circumstances around us are not favorable. And he comes to himself. It is a great experience, because for most of us, it was the turning point in our lives. It was that place where our minds clicked and something turned on, a light went on in our heads, and we for the first time saw that we were where we should not be. The Bible says that when he came to himself, he said. Now this is what is so interesting, and where I'm going to spend just a few minutes. I'm not going to be long with you, that I've learned. He said to himself, when he comes to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish. So he reasons with himself about what are his possibilities. He remembers that his father is a rich man, is a wealthy man, and there are so much means that he has that he of himself had no need to be suffering. Now remember, this was a rude child. This was one who had even wished that his father was dead. But he comes to the point where he says that there is something about my father that gives me the confidence that I can turn around and think about what he has. So the Bible says in verse 17 that he rehearses this speech in verse 18, I should say. He said, I will arise and go to my father and say unto him. Now I want you to follow me, because you can miss this. He comes to himself and he rehearses a speech. This is what we do most of the times. We come to our senses and we speak to God, and we tell him a lot of stuff that we think is necessary to get things right, to get back in favor with God. So when he comes to himself in verse 17, he rehearses a speech and he says, I will go to my father and say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. And this is all true. He knows that. His friends know that. His brother knows that. His father knows that. This is not news to the father. But he rehearses. He comes to himself and he says, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. Verse 19, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants. So he rehearses, he reflects upon the father, this father that he rejected, this father that he turned against, and he rehearses some words that he thinks will be necessary in order to put him back in favor with the father. Now remember, he just came to himself. He spent his whole life rioting and with all different questionable people, and gets to the point where he's eating questionable food and probably drinking questionable water and whatever it is. But he comes to himself. Most of us think that in our experiences in life, once we come to ourselves and we rehearse some type of placitude, some type of prayer, some type of saying, we then go to God, lay before him, and all would be right. But I want to show you something this morning, because this son who comes to himself still has a lot to learn. So he rehearses what he would say to his father. He will admit the errors of his way, which is what we do. And then he goes into verse 19, saying that he will tell his father, I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants. Verse 20 says that he now sets out on his way. And I can picture this boy, if you can follow me, that he's leaving a pig pen with no means. He's eating pig food. So he didn't take a shower. Maybe the rain might fall and wash him off, but he didn't have a change of clothes. Neither did he have, did he shave and set himself right in order to present himself to his father. But he walks and he's heading home. We don't know. We're not told the distance. But the story tells us, but when he was a far way, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion on him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Now, again, follow me in the story and don't jump over those words. The father is waiting in anticipation for the son, in hopefulness for the son, as any parent who knows and who has a child that has strayed, that has gone into a path that is questionable, there is always prayer and there is always hope. There is always a longing and a looking forward to that son or that daughter, to that husband or wife or family member who would come back. But the son is not aware of that. But the father sees him afar off, and the father does something that is really interesting. The Bible says that in verse 20, that he fell on his neck. He runs to him. He fell on his neck and kissed him. Now, if you think about it, usually the person that is in the favorable position, when you meet someone who is in the unfavorable position, would take their head and put it upon your shoulder. Isn't that so? You would hold that person because they're the one that needs help. And you would take them in your arms or you would embrace them to the point and you would put their heads and their torso upon your shoulder. But the Bible says that the father fell upon the son's neck. You're not getting what I'm saying here. The Bible said that the father falls upon the son's neck. But let's go back to remember the speech of the son. Now the father is in his royal robes and he runs to the son who is still smelling a pig and he runs to him and he falls upon him. There is no hesitation. There is no reservation from the perspective of the father. He holds back nothing. He doesn't speak at a distance and talk about, well, coming back. He runs to him and shows him tokens of acceptance. He falls on the father's shoulder, on the son's shoulder, and he kisses him. There are these intimate signs of contact, which shows us that when we come back to God, God is not particular about the things that we think he's particular about. But this is not where I want to spend the rest of the time this morning. I want to go back to the son and his speech, because remember, he rehearsed a speech. He said, I will go to my father and I will tell him, Father, I have sinned against thee and against heaven. And indeed, in verse 21, we see that he does do that. The Bible says, and the son said to the father, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be a son. This is interesting. In verse 18, he says that this is what he will say. He gets to verse 21. And he starts his speech. Remember, this is a son whose father is upon his shoulder, who has messed up. And we are not told how many years and how old he might have been, but his life is questionable and probably one that people have spoken about. And he gets to the point and his father falls upon him. And when he gets a chance to speak, he begins to recite that sermon that he had in his mind. Father, because in his head, this is what his father wants to hear. Father, I've sinned against thee, and we agree that in our lives, that is what our experience is. We tell God that this is who I am, and this is what I have done. But then he gets into what he thinks the father should do. And this is what is interesting. He said in verse 19, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me one of thy hired servants. Now, in verse 21, remember, he came to himself. In verse 21, the son said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be a son. If I'm reading right. And he stops there. Verse 22 is an interjection by the father, where the father cuts off the latter part of verse 19, and that where the son is telling the father that he's no more worthy to be a son, but that he should be a hired servant. Follow me here. That part of the speech is not permitted. The father is not interested in bringing back the son as a servant. Follow the thought of Luke as he writes here. The son thinks that it would be good enough for him to be a servant. But that is not the father's acceptance. That is not what the father has in mind for the son. He intends that when the son comes back, he will be a son. Now if you think about God and his love for us, when we fail and we find ourselves in our messy situations and we come back, God is not planning to restore us to a lower position than we should be in. The Bible tells us that to as many as receive him, to them give he power to become sons. We are going to be joint heirs with Christ. And this is a working example, a worked out parable as to what God intends for us. God intends that when we are restored and we're going to see the attitude of the Father as he cuts off the son's speech. At that part of the speech where he wants to be, or he thinks the father is going to reinstate him as a servant, the father cuts that off and begins to do things that is going to change the mind of the son. You see, you can come to yourself as he did, be heading on your way home, but with a wrong picture of the father in your mind. You can be on your way to glory, but with some stuff about God in your head that is messed up, that is wrong, that is incorrect, that God needs to come out and meet you halfway, stop you in your tracks, and change the way you think. So by the time you get to the house, by the time you get to the kingdom, your mind would be all set. Now notice, the father could have sent the servants to meet the son. He could have sent out a chariot. He could have sent out means to bring him home. But the father in secret, because we are not told that there's necessarily anyone with him. The father runs out to meet the son. He meets him and he embraces him. And if there were people around him, he'd be watching that father, because we don't normally interact to the recluse, to the rejected like that. The father shows that there is something about the son that he can fall upon. There is something within him that he can still lean upon and trust him for. And he runs out and he embraces him and he kisses him. There is the immediate connection. But the father begins to change things. Think about it. Look at what the scripture says. The father said to his servants, bring the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Now we don't have time. We don't have time to talk about these symbols, but a robe is a symbol of royalty. A servant doesn't wear a robe. A servant doesn't wear shoes. A servant doesn't get a ring. So the father begins to change the mind of the son as he comes to himself. As he thinks he's correct in his perception of the father. The father changes the picture in his mind, and there would have been things that went off in his head, and he turns around and then he sets off home. The message today, as you come to yourself, God is going to meet you on your pathway to glory. God is going to meet you as you come to terms with who you are, but he begins to change not you so much, but your perception of him, because we are where we are in our rebellion because of our misconceptions of God. Jesus, the Bible tells us, is the ultimate example of what God is and what God intends to be. The Bible says in 1 John 5:20, for this reason, Jesus came to give us an understanding that we may know him that is true. We sin, we act the way we do, we rebel, we act and we behave in all these different manners because our conception of God is wrong. The picture that we have of God in our mind is incorrect, and we cannot be prepared for glory. We cannot enter into the kingdom with wrong concepts of God in our head. It is God's intent that as we walk on that pathway back home to glory, that we are stopped in our track. Through our hard experiences, through our rough experiences, through our encounters with circumstances, by his providence and his spirit, to change the way we think and the way we see him, to bring about that humility, to bring about the patience and the trustworthiness, to bring about the things in us that when we get to glory, the angels can be comfortable with us. You see, when we get there, we are not just going to be a bunch of pardoned criminals. No, 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 no. We are going to be sons and daughters of God who will change in the process of time by the grace of God and have been shaped into joint heirs, people who can leave the pig pen and head home and sit on the throne with Jesus. When I think about these things, they drive me crazy, because a sinner like me, one like me, I know you folks are good folks, but one like me who found myself in so many questionable things, I say, God, what about me that you're going to see such good, such potential to come and meet me and change the way I see you and then bring me back home? The Bible says that he says, bring hither the fatted calf and kill it and let us make merry. Why would you celebrate over a sinner like me? Why would you do all this just to bring me back to glory and not just allow me into the kingdom as a servant, but to sit me on the right hand along with Jesus? Well, what is it about us? But then I have to change the question, but it is about God. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave us his son as evidence that he intends to restore us, to put us back where we should be. A lot of us don't know where we should be. We are heading to glory. We are heading back to the place where we should be. We were created in God's image and his likeness. So when you come to yourself, as we look at the parable, and this is what I'm going to spend all the rest of my life, if God permits, and before Jesus comes in that program, Hidden Content, is looking at words like this that we tend to so easily jump over. When we come to ourselves, there are things that need to happen in our lives. That's why we need to be patient with our brothers and our sisters, because some of us may have left the pig pen before others. Some of us may be further along the way than others, but we need to understand that the Father is on his journey towards us. It doesn't matter if he meets you first or he meets me first. The point is what he does when he meets us on that road back to glory, on that road back to the kingdom. The Father intends to change us in such a way that by the time we get to the glory, to heaven, if you notice, the Father sets up the Son in such a way that by the time he reaches back home, he doesn't look as he was looking before. The shame and the disgrace from his appearance would have been removed to a great extent. And in the minds of those looking on, they would see someone coming back who would fit the position of a son and not a servant. The Father, in his own actions, rebukes the son's his mindset. He rebukes his sermon. He cuts him off and he sets him right in such a passionate way that the son probably was not even aware of what was happening. All he knows is that he was hugged, he was kissed, and his whole appearance and his whole bearing was being changed. And his father, I can imagine, would have been taking him back home in his arms. This is the message that God intends that we understand this morning, this evening, that God in his work to bring us back to glory is going to stop short of nothing. And if we see what's happening here, the Father himself gets personally involved in our restoration. The Father himself gets personally involved in our salvation and in bringing us back to glory. The Bible tells us that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. You see, I always say that God didn't just send Jesus. God was in Jesus. God intends that we understand that he is not the kind of person that the devil has made him out to be. And he will spare nothing to correct the perceptions that the enemy has tried to implant in our minds as to the kind of father that he is. He has done all that he can, all that he can do to change these pictures in our minds. Oh, what wonderful grace, as the song says. This grace that sees us for something much more than we even see ourselves. This grace that looks beyond our faults and see our needs. This grace that is exhibited daily from the Father. And we are told by the writer that God has enshrouded the earth with an atmosphere of grace as real as the air. It is our opportunity today. It is our privilege as we live, as we still line our right minds to take hold of this grace, to see that the Father is doing all that he can as we are on our way home to change the way that we see him. Because by beholding, we become changed. The psalm says, and I want to just tickle my brother a little bit here, you know, simple words. Amazing grace has always been my song of praise. Yeah, you know, there's a song. I want to dedicate this song to my brother. He's really precious to me. I should have told him this many times. For it was grace that brought my liberty. I never knew, oh, just how much you love me so. You saw beyond my fault, and yes, you saw my need. And I will forever lift my voice to Calvary. Yes, and this is what we should do. To view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous of this grace that caught my sinking soul. He looked beyond my fault, and yes, he saw my need. You know, if not for grace, my soul would be a sinking ship. And I have to say this. I was introduced to religion by my brother. It's interesting. It's a long story. And if not for grace, my soul would be a drifting ship with no safe harbor from the stormy sea. But Calvary's cross blows stronger through the darkest dawn. He looked beyond my faults, and yes, he saw my need. And I will forever lift my voice to Calvary. To view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous is grace that caught my sinking soul. He looked beyond my fault. He looked beyond your fault. You know, when we came to ourselves, he looked beyond our fault. And yes, he saw our need. I pray that your hearts were blessed today. And that by his grace, as we journey home, we will see the interjections of his influence and presence in our lives as he changes our perception of him. As we come to ourselves, we need to accept that there is one way and one intention of God in order to sanctify and prepare us for glory. And that is through Jesus and what he is. I want to say, Father, thank you today that we are still in our right minds, that we are still in a place where we can reflect and we can think on these things. That again, you have given us opportunity to reflect and to look deeply at what you are saying to us. We pray, oh God, that where we have been negligent, where we have overlooked, where we have not paid proper attention to scriptures, that you would take us back so that we can look again deeply at these things and again see the light and the beauty and the power and the majesty of your word, so that we can be changed into the image of Jesus. Again, we pray for your blessings upon Bolton's SDA Church and all those that are listening at this time and looking, that lessons that we have gleaned today about coming to ourselves would be a point of change in our lives. We would see your influence. We would see your interjections, and we would embrace all that you intend to do so that you can get us the glory. And bless us again. To this end, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elder Antoine, and thank you very much for those words of grace reminding us of our Father, our Heavenly Father, and his immense love and his immense grace for us. And thank you, Sister Veronica, for that song. Your grace, God, still amazes us. So I thank all of you who joined with us today. Our services are not yet finished for the day. We continue with our Bible study within the next couple of minutes. But I just want to say thanks to my brother. And though we are joined by blood, we're joined by blood two ways. We carry the blood of our mother. But more importantly, we carry the blood of our Savior. And so, therefore, I'm grateful for that. Thank you very much, Elder. And I pray God will continue to bless you in your ministry, bless your family. And if we don't see each other in this life, we look forward to see each other in the life to come. I will ask you to bless the congregation with a benediction.
May the grace of God and His and the sweet fellowship of His Spirit, may the abiding presence of Jesus be with us as we part one from the other, is our hope and our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much.